Over the past few weeks, I've been exploring the Godot engine and Blender. I modeled my first character, animated it, and implemented some basic third-person movement, as well as a very basic toon shader inspired by Wind Waker. The whole exploration will be covered in other videos, but today we'll be talking about the procedural anime shader I ended up writing. So eventually it was time to give my character a face. I'm going for a chibi look inspired by MapleStory and MapleStory 2, so I started looking at screenshots for reference. After spending some time on Krita trying to decompose the aesthetic into its core elements, I realized it could all be represented as interactions between ellipses. So I started toying with the idea of generating it all procedurally with a shader. When you're trying to do procedural art in a shader, you have to think in a fundamentally different way than how you would normally do 2D rendering. You don't tell the GPU what geometry to draw, but instead you are called for every single fragment, which more or less corresponds to a pixel on screen. You are given the current texture coordinate, which is normalized to a range between 0 and 1. This is commonly referred to as the UV, where U is the X coordinate and V is the Y coordinate. To draw shapes, you have to think in terms of sine distance functions, SDFs, which means that for every fragment, you calculate the distance from the edge of the shape. It's extra useful if the distance goes negative inside the shape, which tells us how far we went into the shape. This can be used to do things like gradients, instead of just filling it with a solid color. The simplest SDF is a circle. You just take the distance from the center and subtract the radius. Once you have implemented the SDF for the shape you want to draw, it's as simple as using the step or smooth step functions to decide the fragment color when we are inside the shape. The step function gives a hard edge. It's like an if statement. If the distance is below some value, it returns 1, otherwise it returns 0. This is a bit more efficient than actual if statements, because GPUs aren't really good at branching. What we actually want, though, is the smooth step function, which is the same except it smoothly fades from 0 to 1 over a range of values. This can be used to control how hard the edges are, since pixel perfect would be ugly. The value from the step function can be simply used with mix to interpolate between the background color and the shape color. I also use it as the alpha to have a transparent background. We can easily turn this into an ellipse by scaling the distance to the center by the size of the ellipse, effectively distorting space by the aspect ratio of the ellipse. Which means that we can now treat this like a circle and simply subtract a fixed radius from the length of the distorted distance vector. My implementation simply divides the distance vector by the size, calculates the length, and multiplies by the smaller size, which is the same as multiplying by the aspect ratio. The great thing about SDFs is that it's really easy to do operations between shapes. For example, we can draw the intersection between two shapes by simply taking the maximum of the two SDFs. Similarly, we can combine two shapes by taking the minimum SDF, or interpolate between two distances to morph between two shapes. You can also use a smooth minimum function to combine shapes with smoother edges. I recommend checking out The Art of Code for some awesome shader toy remarching stuff. That's pretty much where I picked up most of the basics. I defined the main shape of the eye as the intersection between two ellipses, which seems good enough to define most anime eye shapes. Then I needed to figure out how to draw a border. This turns out to be quite straightforward. You just define a point along the SDF where the border should be, then you calculate the distance from that point, subtract the border thickness, and that's the SDF for the border. It's basically a circle SDF, but in one dimension. Of course, a simple solid border won't do, so for the anime aesthetic, we need the thickness to fall off smoothly. At first, I tried to do separate borders for the top and bottom ellipses, but I quickly realized that it's much easier to just use the entire shape's border and define a fall-off ellipse, where the thickness of the border scales down as we approach the edge. I had to do a hard edge smooth step on the fall-off ellipse. That's because, even if the thickness is zero, we have some fragment that just happen to be close enough to the center of the border to make it visible outside of the ellipse. So we need to completely zero out the border smooth step when we are outside of the fall-off ellipse. This looks exactly like the kind of border I need, and I could define multiple fall-off ellipses to have multiple parts of the eye with the border. I ended up adjusting the math a bit, so that the border leans towards the outside of the shape, instead of being centered, making the shape slightly more interesting. I made the border offset adjustable, which is as easy as offsetting the UVs we pass to the shape SDF, and using this offset SDF just for the border. I also added a rotation for the border, which is achieved by rotating the UVs we pass to the SDF by the opposite of the rotation. This can be done by constructing a simple 2D rotation matrix, with the sine and cosine of the angle. Except I completely messed it up by trying to do it without a matrix. After playing around a bit with the border, I started working on the iris. This is a straightforward ellipse. We just need to make sure to intersect it with the main shape, and make sure that the border has higher priority, so that the iris doesn't render over it. Next, I defined the highlight area as another ellipse, outside of which the colors are attenuated by some amount. I want this to have a fairly sharp edge. This is starting to look like an anime eye. It still looks quite dead because we don't have the pupil and the rim lighting. I added the iris gradient, which I defined as some attenuation on the iris color. I also decided to make an adjustable offset for this gradient, in the same way that I did the border offset. This makes the gradient feel a little more interesting, and gives a slight sense of perspective and lighting. After that, I defined the pupil, which is a straightforward ellipse. At this point, I was thinking of ways to make the shape even more interesting, so I decided to try interpolating between a rectangle and the ellipse. This way, I would have a parameter to make the shape more or less rounded. I struggled quite a bit making the interpolation work. Just mixing between the SDFs made the edge too blurry. Eventually, I came up with something that worked. I did a smooth minimum between a rectangle and the ellipse. Then I scaled the rectangle up with the squareness amount. This way the corners would poke through the ellipse. This gave me exactly the kind of squareness I wanted. I got the smooth minimum function from the Art of Code's shader toys. The eye almost looks alive now, and the last element that really brings it to life will be the rim lighting, which is simply two little white ellipses. I made this adjustable in both position and rotation. Now it's really starting to look convincing. I spent some time adding a second border with its own offset and rotation, and played a bit with the parameters to make a nice looking eye. At this point, I realized that my smooth step don't always look smooth. When I zoom out, they become pixelated. I need to scale them based on distance. Godot shaders give us the z-coordinate in view space. View space means that it's relative to the camera, so it's the z-distance between the surface of the eye and the camera, which is exactly what we need. The simplest way to scale the smooth steps is to just divide the SDF by the z-distance. That way, when we are far away, the SDF will return a much smaller range of values, making this smooth step more blurry. This is still not perfect. as the rims noticeably get slightly bigger as we zoom out, because of how the smooth step works, but it's good enough. We can make tiny adjustments by adding or subtracting some small amount from the STF. I actually like this better than perfect scaling, because I can decide what I will emphasize at different distances, so that it can always look good. At this point, I need to start cleaning up the code a bit. I pulled out some stuff into functions, so that I can draw two eyes at specific locations. Remapping our eye code to work on specific ranges of UVs is simpler than you might think. All you have to do is subtract the area's coordinates and scale by the area size, which effectively means scaling around the area position as the pivot point. Now we can pass these transformed UVs to the eye function, which will still be operating in the normalized 0 to 1 UV space. To mirror the other eye, I just set the UV area to be negative width. But we don't actually want to flip everything, so I add a parameter to flip the rim positions and the rotation. I added an extra border to be used for the eyebrows. I also added another transformation to the UVs, so that you can remap the eyes to any range of UVs you want, which is useful if you want to map it to a complex mesh. The way I ended up mapping the eyes to the model was by creating a duplicate surface slightly raised above the face of the model. Then I UV projected that from the front. That way there is as little distortion as possible. To complete the anime aesthetic, I modified the depth buffer just for the eye fragments. This way the engine thinks that the eyes are in front of the hair, without actually moving or messing with the perspective. This makes the eyes render through the hair with correct perspective. To make the character look a bit more alive, I made the eyes track the camera horizontally. I couldn't be bothered to make it accurate. That would require actually having a pivot point for the eyes. Instead, I just added an adjustable multiplier. I tweaked this until the eyes match up well enough. I also implemented some half-assed blink. I did this by adding a parameter that moves the ellipses closer together, which effectively makes the eye look like it's closing. This is not perfect and it causes some border artifacts, but it's good enough for blinking. And that's pretty much it. Cute anime eyes generated entirely with math in a shader. Truly the peak of modern technology. I released the shader code into the public domain. You can find it on my GitHub. Link in the description.